and at the time, close when the officer's off shooting occurred. Today's town hall, obviously, is related to the officer's off shooting that occurred last Thursday morning at approximately 10 a.m. Mr. Luis Gonzaga. With that, I will update you on what we have resulted from the investigation so far, and I'll do so by giving you what has come from the statement that have been gleaned by the homicide investigation. There are three independent investigations going forward right now. This case is 6 days old. One by the homicide division, the district attorney, another by the district attorney's office, and another by the office of the assault. If anybody needs language assistance, we will have Spanish speaking language assistance available. So with that, on Thursday, April 7, 2016, at approximately 9:57 a.m., the Department of Public Health and Homeless Outreach team members responded to the area of 17th and 18th and Shaw to follow up on a complaint of a baby crying in the area of homeless encampments. Interviews with those hot team members state that when they arrived, they saw a male subject, later identified as Mr. Luis Gongora, forcefully kicking and bouncing a basketball off parked cars in the area. They searched for the crying baby and never located any baby. They did come in contact with and spoke to an obviously pregnant woman. They offered their assistance with an appointment she had related to her pregnancy. After this contact, they were prepared to leave the area when they again observed Mr. Gongora. The hot team workers described Mr. Gongora as appearing in an altered mental state, either mentally or chemically induced, and they saw that he was in possession of a large knife. One hot team member described his actions as swinging indiscriminately as he walked down the street. The other hot team member in an interview with homicide described him as swinging the knife around in a choppy motion. The workers conferred and agreed that the police department needed to be called. They called 911 and provided a physical description of Mr. Gongora and his actions. The senior hot team member told investigators it's only about the fifth time in the 10 years working on the hot team that she felt the need to call police. Mission station units arrived. The first two units arrived on the scene, a sergeant and an officer who happens to be CIT trained. They exited their patrol vehicles, contacted the hot team members who directed them to the area where they last saw Mr. Gongora. A third officer, a Spanish speaker from Mission Station, also arrived on scene as the first two officers were just contacting Mr. Gongora. According to officer interviews, officers located Mr. Gongora seated on the sidewalk with a large knife in his hand and the blade pointed up. They ordered him to put it down multiple times, which can be heard on the audio tape, the audio portion of the videotape that's been out in the media. The verbal orders were given in English and Spanish according to the officer. Mr. Gongora briefly placed the knife down with his hand still on top of the handle, only to quickly pick the knife back up again. An officer armed with our left lethal beanbag shotgun delivered four beanbags at Mr. Gongora in an effort to disarm him. At that point in time, the officers tell interviewers that he stood up and ran at one of the officers with the knife in his hand. Investigators spoke with at least 12 civilian witnesses at the scene. Their quotes are on signboards to my left. Their interviews range from observing the officer get off the ground and lunge at the officers to a witness who heard officers yelling and shots but did not see the shooting. You can reference here for the various quotes. Back to the officer interviews, the officers quickly back away from Mr. Gongora, as again can be seen in the video as they retreat back. Mr. Gongora had the knife in hand. Officers stated they feared that Mr. Gongora was going to kill one of them and fire the weapons in defense of themselves. Mr. Gongora was struck and fell to the ground. Officers secured the knife female arrived, treated and transported Mr. Pagongor to General Hospital, where he did not survive his injuries. The officers involved, one is a sergeant with 17 years in the police department, much of that here at Mission Station.
Name.
The other names of the officers will be released within days of the within 10 days of this officer-involved shooting, unless there's an articulated threat to those officers, as has been the department's practice. There are no names currently that have not been put out in the public in any officer-involved shooting. The other officer has 13 years in law enforcement, 9 years with another agency, and 4 years with the San Francisco Police Department. The third officer who responded to the scene and did not fire his weapon is in his 15th year in the department. He is also CIT trained. There were, as I said, there were four beanbag rounds discharged. Those casings were at the scene. There were seven 40 caliber casings found at the scene, seven shots fired by the two officers. Preliminary medical examiner report states that Mr. Gongor was struck 6 times. That concludes what I have with regard to prepared comment. I reached out to the only family member that we have contact information for, obviously, to apologize for what happened and to offer the department's condolences to the person who is Mr. Gongor. With that, I will open it up to any questions from the community. I would ask that if anybody's here on their lunch hour, which is why we have this, and you could get back to work, if they could give them priority to questions. If anybody just has a comment to make, the podium is available. Comments will be limited to 2 minutes.
I was a security guard right there, and I left one of the homeless guys alive. You know, I saw him walking that day. He was one of the members from the shelter on 16th Street. His name is Jose Aleman. He's from Nicaragua. And that day I saw him walking alive, and then he was tired. You know, he lay down on the floor. When I came out of the store, I saw him shooting the blood was very cold and very hard for him, so I was going on fever. And then I went back. Now, later, when I was sleeping, I saw police voices. Get up, get up! Wake up, get up! You know? And I was afraid because I got hit by police a couple of times by Officer Gordon. She's undercover officer. You know, it took me years to find out who she was. While I was Officer Molina and Officer Sanchez were holding me in handcuffs. You know, it happened on one day in my scary seat, right across from last person is talking now, that's what's close, you know? And so you guys took me to jail with no evidence, you know, you destroyed my marriage. On top of that, the system saved me, you know, because it was a violation of constitutional rights. You guys violated the 4 amendments. A lot of them, the 18 amendments. Is it what it's called? Why? Because the officers carried him and they, this is like they didn't carry him.
The Office of Citizen Complaints is right here and they can take a complaint for you.
True.
You guys destroyed my business, please tell your father. I'm going to come, we're going to be over and over again until I lose my business. For no reason.
Thank you.
For no reason.
Thank you.
And it's a lie.
Thank you. Of the other people that are also waiting to speak.
This is very important.
I know, the sergeant can take your...
My life, my freedom, that I'm waiting for, I need to get aware of this.
I understand.
I got problems, I got issues because for you guys.
I understand, the sergeant can take your complaint offline. Thank you. actually bagged and has in storage the contents of that particular.
Are your officers trained in dealing with the trauma post-traumatic stress and mental illness?
They have some experience with it, but obviously in the front of public health, they're the experts.
Why would they use sticks in front of these homeless people to knock down the water tank?
Thank you. that man was so eloquent. That's what I was going to say. Why? What's the brush? Every person I talk to, when the San Francisco police kill somebody, they say, well, it's a hurry. Alex Manta was killed so quickly after the police arrived. Mario Woods was killed so quickly after the police arrived. He was killed so quickly. Like, the police should not be afraid. They have guns. If they are afraid, they should not be in that job. Because fearful people make big mistakes. You know that, I'm sure you are really upset about this because police are putting themselves in danger. Because pretty soon, some crazy person with a gun is going to do what they did in New York after Mr. Barnum was killed. And that's going to be really sad. So anyway, I think people should take time to think. Thank you.
Yeah.
before I left.
Just for perspective, this is an unusual place for me to be. A little over a year ago, I was working in Allied Law Enforcement in the Pennsylvania Department of Corrections. I've been involved in many planned and unplanned uses of force. I've had training and force continuing in various defensive tactics, as well as quite a bit in de-escalation. I watch a circumstance unfold in less than 30 seconds from contact to lethal force. I'm very concerned. And I'm very concerned for public safety. Our public includes the rent-paying members of our neighborhoods, it includes our homeless and houseless neighbors, and it includes you, police. And I know that you know that the circumstances we're witnessing in this room right now are not contributing to the safety of the officers and the contributing to anyone else's safety. I want you to know some of the repercussions of what's happened. At roughly the time that, in fact, almost exactly the same time, the officers were making contact with the police and abroad, I was speaking with some of our homeless neighbors in Golden Gate Park, doing what I often do, spending some time with them, providing little comfort that I can provide. Captain, you and I have met in that context in Castro. And one of the men that I contacted, as we spoke, had a large knife sitting next to him. That was not an act of aggression. Living on our streets and having a knife is no more an act of aggression than this. So we don't have to.
Yes, you did. That's why you're nephew.
Yeah.
You are
no.
That's why you're nephew. That's why you're nephew.
Propaganda building.
Jerry, take the witness.
I stated that the former police commissioner has said this to the president of the police commission. I think that we need to change the policy of actually having police come out and hold these press conferences. We are trying to prove that this is what happened. I don't want you to prove anything. I am not jumping to conclusions about what happened here, but I also think that it's irresponsible for SFPD to do that. So I ask you, please, stop saying anything until your own investigation is complete. Mayor, to please direct the police department to stop trying to escape to the public.
Yeah. 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 To take a stand, call for his job.
Last point to the mayor. We need the mayor to step up and actually show the leadership from this point. Why isn't the mayor calling on the federal government, not cops, but the Civil Rights Division of the Justice Department to come in and actually do a legally binding investigation of this police department?
Yeah.
Blaming the homeless for what happened by cracking down on the homeless is not a solution.
Yeah.
his woman in the face or something. I don't condone that either. But you know what I mean? It was the same kind of motherfucking kitchen knife. We all got that one. I know where that one's from. It's from Walmart. It's about $3.49. I got one of those. I also have the Ginsu's. I got all the different knives. We all do. Because we cook. And people on the street cook too. But you know what? Get the fuck out of Israel. We want the woman to represent. Secondly, I was at the last police commission meeting in which the police department spoke of the sanctity of life. The videos were shown by activists of two incidents in which men that were mostly challenged were disarmed by using a net and the other by waiting patiently with shields until they rushed in and tackled the person. There were four police officers sitting behind me at the commission. I turned and said, "What do you think?" They said they were lucky. I said, "No. They were patient, they were courageous, and they were compassionate."
That's right.
The history of the police in this country is not to protect and serve the people. The first police force was to track down slaves who had gotten away from their owners. The second movement was to arrest and attack and beat and kill labor movements. So it has not been the history of this country for the police to serve. If you want to get the trust of this community, who has so much grief, you're mainly hearing the anger, but believe me, underneath this is grief and love for each other, then we want you to meet with us without your weapons.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you are too afraid to walk the streets, we want a moratorium on weapons for 6 months to see what that does.
Talking to all these fabulous conscious people in the room. Yeah.
which are a lot of profit, non-profit fears as far as I'm concerned, and college race training. But the reality is, I think that there's an amount of money owed immediately to house the folks on Shotwell who are re-traumatized by what you all have done to them,
yeah.
And also for the act of violating the UN Declaration on Indigenous Peoples, which is if Indigenous people cross to this United States of America, they should never be considered illegal because no one is illegal. Justice for
and all I was trying to do was get away. Is excessive